Good evening. I'm William Cooper, and you're listening to The Hour of the Time. Well, if you've been sitting out there wondering where your copy of issue number 7 of Veritas is at, it's somewhere out there in cyberspace, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, we've been having some very serious computer problems. It seems as fast as we prepare the newspaper, the computer eats it. And I mean eats it. We had just upgraded to some new software, and we are working feverishly to get this problem straightened out, and thought we had it fixed today. We reloaded the template for the paper and began to do the layout on the computer again. And late this evening, the computer ate that layout. So we are going to get up early in the morning and begin again. I don't know what the problem is. I'm no computer wizard. But we're going to either get it straightened out tomorrow, or we're going to take this new software completely off our computer and work with the old software that worked. So for those of you who are waiting, don't despair. You will get your promised copy of Veritas. I can't tell you when, but I can tell you you will get it. And you will all get the exact number of issues that you subscribed to. Because of this, I uploaded to USA Forever News Group today an advanced copy of the lead article as a file attached to the message that I posted letting people know that I was doing this. And the only reason that I did it, ladies and gentlemen, is because the article is extremely important. It concerns Michael New. And, of course, we all know that his court-martial will begin shortly. I also see that many people are calling upon American citizens to call the Army and call Congress and have this court-martial canceled. Don't do that. Do not do that. Michael New does not want you to do that. I do not want you to do that. No loyal American patriot wants anyone to do that. We must challenge the legality of the president's ability to assign United States military personnel under the United Nations flag and under foreign commanders. If you're successful in stopping this court-martial, you will only prolong his ability to do that. Sometimes you people really are upsetting. I don't know what you're thinking of. I don't know how you get off in these little cul-de-sacs and spin around chasing your tail like you do. But I'll tell you this, you had better stop it. You'd better screw your head on straight. And you better start playing this game the way it's supposed to be played, not the way the other side wants you to play it. We're engaged in a battle, World War III, if you will. At stake is your liberty. If you lose, you will become a slave. You may end up in a labor camp or dead. This is not some joke that we're playing. This isn't a playground with a sandbox. And oh, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, all of you have been passing around this bullshit that there was a constitutional convention going on in Cincinnati. You're not playing with a full deck of cards either. It was a meeting of Federalists. It was not a constitutional convention and could not have been one even if they wanted it to be. None of them were empowered by their states or anyone else to act in behalf of anybody. It wasn't anything like the Conference of States. And the more you pass around this bullshit and the more you cater to things like the Montana militia and their constant stream of disinformation, and the Patriot Facts Network, which probably has not promulgated anything across its fax machines that even resembles the truth in any six-month period of time that I'm aware of. You had better stop it. You act like a bunch of children. Somebody hands you a popsicle, so you take a lick and pass it on. You have no idea what it's made out of, do you? You don't know what liquid went into the ice tray with a little bit of flavoring around that stick that you're sucking on. You'd better wise up. Could be frozen urine, for all you know. And from my experience with most people out there, not most of the listeners of this broadcast, but most people out there who pretend to be patriots, it probably is. Casting the Molten Sea. As the spiritual gifts of the sons of Seth flowered in Solomon, the wisest of men, and enabled him to conceive and design a marvelous temple, according to the plan of his creator Jehovah, so Hiram, the clever craftsman, embodied within himself the consummate skill of a long line of ancestral artificers. He possessed the concentrated quintessence of the material knowledge gained by the sons of Cain while they wrought from the wilderness of the world a concrete civilization. And in the execution of the wonderful Temple of Solomon, this superlative skill found full fruition. Thus the glorious edifice was the chef d'oeuvre of both lines, an embodiment of the sublime spirituality of the churchmen, the sons of Seth, combined with the superlative skill of the craftsmen, the sons of Cain. So far the honors were even, the achievement equal. Solomon was contented. He had carried out the design transmitted to him. He had a place of worship worthy of the Lord he revered, but the soul of Hiram was not satisfied. Armed with the art of ages, he had constructed an incomparable masterpiece in architecture. But the design had not been his own. He had been merely the tool of an unseen architect, Jehovah, working through an intermediary, Solomon. This rankled in his heart, for it was as necessary for him to as originate as it was for him to breathe. Now in that ancient age when Cain and Abel first found themselves upon earth, Abel contentedly cared for the flocks created like himself and his parents, Adam and Eve, by Jehovah. But in Cain, semi-divine progeny of the Lucifer spirit, Samael and Eve, the creature of Jehovah, divine incentive to original effort burned. He tilled the field and made two blades of grass grow where one grew before. The creative instinct must have expression. Hiram, being the focus of and having inherited all the crafts of Cain, was also invested with the spirit of Samael, intensified in commensurate ratio. Therefore, he was consumed by an overpowering urge to add something to the temple that would eclipse the rest of the structure in beauty and importance. Out of the travail of his spirit was born the conception of the Molten Sea. And this great ideal he proceeded to carry into execution, though heaven and earth held their breath in awe at the audacity of his purpose. The Bible gives very little information about the Molten Sea. In 2 Chronicles, the 4th chapter, we learn that Hiram made such a vessel, that it was of considerable size, that it stood upon 12 oxen arranged so that their heads were at the periphery of this circular basin and their hind parts were towards its center. It was intended solely for use by the priests. Much is said of a nature to bewilder the reader, but the above salient points prove the signal importance of this instrument, as we shall see when we study and compare the Masonic account with this veiled word of the Bible. And this is the Masonic story. When Hiram had about completed the temple, He commenced to cast the various vessels required in the service according to designs made by Solomon as agent of Jehovah. Chief among these was the great laver, intended to hold the bath of purification through which all priests must pass to enter upon the service of the Lord. This and all the lesser vessels were successfully cast by Hiram, as recorded in the Bible. But there is an important distinction between the vessel and the molten sea which it was designed by Hiram to contain, and until that had been successfully poured, the vessel was without virtue, so far as purifying properties were concerned. Until then, it could no more cleanse the sin-stained soul than could a dry basin be utilized to cleanse the body. Nor could Solomon speak the word, the formula for this wonderful work. None but Hiram knew it. This work was to be his masterpiece, and if he succeeded, his art would have lifted him above the human and made him divine like the Elohim Jehovah. In the Garden of Eden, his divine progenitor Samael had assured his mother Eve that she might become as the Elohim if she ate of the tree of knowledge. For ages, his ancestors had wrought in the world through the accumulated skill of the sons of Cain, and edifice had been reared wherein Jehovah hid himself behind the veil and communed only with his chosen priests, the sons of Seth. And folks, I'm going to break away from the text at this point to remind you that I have revealed to you on many occasions that once a Freemason has reached the honorary degree of the 33rd degree, there are degrees above that point that are behind the veil. You see, these men become priests. In Lucifer's service, and work silently, unknown to the world, behind the veil. Let me continue. Oh, I might add that many people who have gone through the temple service or the temple initiation of the Mormon Church have revealed, and let me add that they have removed this portion of their temple ceremony because of these revelations. They revealed that at a certain part during the ceremony, the congregation would call out to God, and from behind the veil, Lucifer would answer. This is well documented. It's not something that I'm making up. Some of the best researchers in this area are the Tanners in Salt Lake City. I continue. The sons of Cain were thrust out of the temple which they had built, as their father Cain had been driven from the garden which he had tilled. This Hiram felt to be an outrage and an injustice, so he applied himself to prepare the means whereby the sons of Cain might rend the veil and open the way to God for whosoever will. But remember, the God of the sons of Cain is, has always been, and always will be, Lucifer. To this end, he sent messengers over the world to collect all the metals with which the sons of Cain had ever wrought. With his hammer, he pulverized them and placed them in a fiery furnace to extract by alchemistry from each particle the quintessence of knowledge derived in the experience of working with it. Thus, the combined quintessence of these various base metals would form a spiritual sublimate of knowledge, incomparable in potency, valuable beyond all earthly things. Being of ultimate purity, it would contain no color, but resemble a sea of glass. Whoever should love in it would find himself endowed with perpetual youth. No philosopher could compare with him in wisdom. This white stone knowledge would even enable him to lift the veil of invisibility and meet the superhuman hierarchs who work in the world with a potency undreamt of by the masses. In reality, folks, they are known as the Illuminati, and there's nothing mysterious about them whatsoever. I continue. Masonic traditions tell us that Hiram's preparations were so perfect that success would have been assured had not treachery triumphed. But the incompetent craftsmen whom Hiram had been unable to initiate into the higher degrees conspired to pour water into the vessel cast to receive the molten sea. For they knew that the Son of Fire was unskilled in the manipulation of the watery element and could not combine it with his wonderful alloy. Thus, by frustrating Hiram's cherished plan and spoiling his masterpiece, they aimed to revenge themselves upon the master. Solomon had been privately informed of the nefarious plot, but jealousy on account of the Queen of Sheba bound his tongue and stayed his arm, for he hoped that when the ambitious plan of Hiram failed, the affections of the queen would turn from his humiliated rival to himself. He therefore closed eyes and ears to plot and plotters. When Hiram confidently pulled the plugs, the liquid fire rushed out, was met by the water, and there was a roar that seemed to shake heaven and earth. While the elements boiled and battled, all but Hiram hid their faces at the awful havoc. Then from the center of the raging fire, he heard the call of Tubal-Cain, bidding him jump into the molten sea. Full of faith in his ancestor, who had gone before him upon the path of fire, Hiram obeyed and plunged fearlessly into the flames. Sinking through the disintegrated bottle into the bottom of the vessel, he was conducted successfully through 9 arc-like layers of the earth to the center, where he found himself in the presence of Cain, the founder of his family, who gave him instructions relative to blending water and fire, and who furnished him with a new hammer and a new word which would enable him to produce these results. Cain looked into the future and uttered a prophecy which has been partly fulfilled. What remains is in process of realization day by day, and as surely as time goes on, all will come to pass. "You, Hiram," said Cain, "are destined to die with hopes unfulfilled, but many sons will be born to the widow and keep your memory green through the ages, and at length one will come who is greater than you. You shall not wake till the Lion of Judah raises you with the powerful grip of his paw. This day you have received your baptism of fire, but he shall baptize you with water and with spirit. You and every son of the widow who will come to him, greater than Solomon, he will build a new city and a temple wherein the nations may worship. The sons of Cain and the sons of Seth shall there meet in peace at the Sea of Glass. And as Melchizedek, king of Salem," Salem means peace, "and priest of God, ministered to Abraham, the father of nations, when mankind was yet in its infancy, so shall this new light combined in himself, the dual office of king and priest, after the order of Melchizedek, he shall judge the nations with the law of love, and to him that overcometh will be given a white stone with a name that will serve as passport to the temple. There he may meet the king face to face." Hiram was again conducted to the surface of the earth, and as he walked from the scene of his shattered ambition, the conspirators set upon and fatally wounded him. But before he expired, he hid the hammer and disc upon which he had inscribed the word. This was never found until ages later, when Hiram, the widow's son, was reborn as Lazarus and became the friend and pupil of the Lion of Judah, who raised him from death through initiation. When the hammer was found, it had the shape of a cross, and the disc had become a rose. Let me read this to you again in case it slipped beyond your hearing. Hiram was again conducted to the surface of the earth, and as he walked from the scene of his shattered ambition, the conspirators set upon and fatally wounded him. But before he expired, he hid the hammer and disc upon which he had inscribed the word. This was never found until ages later, when Hiram, the widow's son, was reborn as Lazarus and became the friend and pupil of the Lion of Judah, who raised him from death through initiation. When the hammer was found, it had the shape of a cross, and the disc had become a rose. Therefore, Hiram took his place among the immortals under the new and symbolical name Christian Rosenkreutz. He founded the order of temple builders which bears his name. In that order, aspiring souls are still instructed how to fuse the base metals and make the white stone. The symbology of the foregoing, ladies and gentlemen, will be explained before I'm done with you. Among all the characters mentioned in the Bible, none is more mysterious than Melchizedek, said to be without father, mother, or earthly kin, and holding the dual office of king and priest, symbolized by the cross in the crown. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, I said in my book, I wrote it, I've been telling you for years, that when the New World Order comes into being, is cemented its power in the world, one will be seated upon the throne of the world, who will serve as king and charismatic religious leader, both in the same office, and he will be said to be Maitreya, to be the promised Messiah of the Jews, and to be the Christ who has returned. That I'm telling you right now, he will be none of those. It will be a deception the likes of which you cannot even conceive of, brought about by these men. Paul, in his epistle to the Hebrews, gives us most information showing the connection between Christ and Melchizedek, both of them kings and high priests, but of different dispensations. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. No man taketh this honor unto himself, but he that is called of God, as was Aaron. So also Christ glorified not himself to be made a high priest, but he that said unto him, Thou art my Son, today I have begotten thee. As he saith also in another place, Thou art a priest for the age after the order of Melchizedek, who in the day of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications, with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared, though he were a son, yet learned. The obedience by the things he suffered. And being made perfect, he became author of eternal salvation unto all that obey him, called of God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek, of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of kings, and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace, without father, without mother, without ancestors, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continually. And here men that die, the Levites, receive tithes. And there he receiveth them of whom it is witnessed that he liveth. If therefore perfection were by the law and its priesthood, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron? For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning the priesthood. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth another priest, who is made not after the law of carnal commandments, but after the power of an endless life. For he testifies, Thou art a priest for the age after the order of Melchizedek. By so much was Jesus made the surety of a betterment. That should be of a better testament. But ladies and gentlemen, this is all false, if the Bible is true. If the history of what Jesus said, and if the Bible is accurate, Jesus refused the crown, didn't he? I continue. Because he continueth ever and has an age lasting priesthood.